Hi, this is Scott Wilkinson, host of Home Theater Geeks. In episode 153, I chat with THX senior video engineer Eric Gemmer about THX video certification. So stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Home Theater Geeks is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Home Theater Geeks with Scott Wilkinson, recorded April 1st, 2013, episode 153, THX Video Certification. This episode of Home Theater Geeks is brought to you by Manpacks, manly goods on a schedule. Get started today and have underwear, socks, toiletries, shaving supplies, and more delivered to your door. Visit manpacks.com/twit and get $10 off your first order of $30 or more, or buy a $50 gift card for $40. Hey there, Scott Wilkinson here, the Home Theater Geek. This week's guest geek is Eric Gemmer, senior video engineer at THX, to talk all about THX video certification. Hey, Eric, welcome to the show.
For having me on.
Yeah, thanks so much. You're just down the road from our mothership in Petaluma, and I hear it's raining up there, eh?
Oh, yeah, it's coming down pretty good. They say it's going to stop pretty soon, and I've forgotten my overcoat. Very strange. We have had a really dry year, and then all of a sudden we have one day of rain, and it's like, oh, well, this is different.
Well, I hope it stops before you head home. So anyway, those of you who are watching live at live.twit.tv or logged into the chat room at irc.twit.tv can post questions for Eric as we go, and I'll pass along as many as I can. So, Eric, let's start with the process of THX certification of video products. When did THX start doing that? I know they've been doing audio for a long time and video for, I think, somewhat less time, right?
That's right. I started in 2006, and our first video certification product, starting with this resurgence of the program, was a TiVo set-top box. And we talked to a number of people about whether they would like to submit a display for certification, and different people started to send us samples. And that's usually how we begin with our customers, is they will send in a representative sample of something they'd like to have certified. And then I run it through a number of tests to see if it's a product that could conform, or maybe could be engineered to conform to our specification.
But the first one wasn't a display. That's interesting. It was one of the TiVo boxes. Are TiVo boxes still certified up to the current model, or was that a generation or two ago?
Oh, the TiVo Series 3 and TiVo Series 4 boxes are currently certified, and I believe you'll be watching the trades and see what happens when they come out with their new one this year.
Mm-hmm.
But then we moved on to display products, and the Runco DLP projector was a very early candidate for certification, and did a marvelous job. So they've been a very early partner and been carrying on since, 2007, I'd say.
Do you remember the model number of that Runco?
VX2, I think.
And yeah, then that's pretty high-end.
And then we did a VX22, which was their first 1080p DLP projector, among others.
Mm-hmm. So let's go through the process of THX certification. And we have a diagram that will illustrate this as we talk about it. How does a manufacturer get started with certification? What are the steps in the process?
Well, sometimes it's initiated by a corporation. Sometimes it's initiated by our sales team, who says, oh, here's an interesting product, and perhaps they would be interested in certifying something with us. So you can see in the first square, it's about prototype development. And what they do is they decide what they might want to have certified, and they build one by hand. That's a prototype. Right after that, they send it in to THX, and they've already got a list of specifications from us, and they try to build it to those requirements. And so we test it to see how it's doing. The best way is when they send an engineer. So most flat panel products have been sent with an engineer from the home office who's in the picture quality group. And they sit and they tune the TV so that the THX cinema mode is accurate to BT709 and some other things that we ask them to do. If they want to have a bright room mode, they will tune that mode and we'll all agree on the background settings for that. If it has a 3D capability, we would have THX 3D cinema mode. There's no bright room mode for 3D because if you're sitting in a bright room, the 3D image is all compromised because of wearing glasses.
Well, so, yeah, for one thing, certainly in 3D, you lose so much light by the time it from the time it leaves the TV to the time it reaches your eye that most TVs, in my experience, have to be in their absolute brightest mode anyway for 3D mode. So it's almost kind of a moot point there in terms of you can't really have a bright room mode because it's already as bright as it can possibly be.
Well, depending on the technology, with a shutter glasses approach, you get about 25% of the light through to your eye. Mm. So when we do the measurements, we put the actual glasses, and they're also usually prototypes, in front of the spectroradiometer. Then we're measuring through the lens of the glasses and into the TV in the 3D picture mode. This gives us, gives the client a way to set up those offsets. Because when you take the glasses off, the colors won't look right at all. There's always a shift, a color shift, because of the lenses.
By the way, here's a side note question. You mentioned that through active glasses, you get about 25% of the light through to your eye. In other words, the glasses filter out 75% of the light coming from the TV. What are those numbers with respect to passive 3D glasses?
Well, we've been seeing about 50%. But the interesting thing is that in a passive system, there are always LCDs. So you can have an extraordinarily bright backlight system and compensate for any kind of loss you would have to reach the luminance specification we require for 3D. Whereas when you have optically switched 3D, like active glasses, you have a period of time when the television is actually off and the lenses are switching and then it turns back on. So it isn't just the fact that you have a tinted lens, it's the fact that there's a ramping up and a ramping down of the actual light that's hitting your eyes. So that's called the shutter to display timing. And we test for that, because if the timing is in error, you start to lose your 3D fusion. Fusing means that the images kind of break apart. They don't look like they're in the right planes in Z space. So
would you also be getting crosstalk under those conditions? That is, seeing the right image in the left eye and vice versa?
It would depend. If the let's say the lens was opening too soon on one eye compared to the other eye, or before the light had extinguished on the screen, you might see the wrong image in the wrong eye. Mm-hmm. We see that that's been pretty well cured. Nowadays, the last two seasons, we don't have a shutter to display timing issues. I built a rig to actually measure the rise time and fall time of the shutters, because early on, they didn't really measure it themselves. And we said, well, look, in the left eye, it's doing this. In the right eye, the ramp is starting here, so many milliseconds different from the black point. So we were getting interocular errors. And that means the difference between the two eyes. It could be the light level. It could be crosstalk, and in some cases, it can be whether color is correct.
Wow. So the color might be different in each eye as well.
Yeah. And we've had prototype glasses where the lenses aren't quite as refined as in the manufacturing process. So we'll say, oh, well, this set of glasses, the right eye seems to be quite a bit different. And then we bring another pair. They always bring two or three pair. And sometimes they bring two or three pair per TV because we test every size.
Oh, some manufacturers make glasses of different size, you mean? Or you mean different screen size?
The different screen sizes.
I see. I know Sony used to actually make two sizes of glasses as well. I don't know if they still do, one for kids and one for adults. This may also partly answer, the question of 3D sickness. I posted a poll on AVS Forum a couple weeks ago about, do you suffer from 3D sickness? And some of the responses were, well, yes, but only with active glasses.
Well, probably the flash rate is causing some discomfort. We ask them to refresh the screen faster than 24 frames. Let's say you're watching a regular 2D movie. Usually the TV is extracting the pull down and presenting the movie at 24, or it's a 24 frame movie coming out of your Blu-ray player. Well, if you're watching a TV show that's 3D and it's only flashing at double frame rate, so it's 24 in each eye, that's very slow. So we ask them to refresh faster. There's also been some people saying at some stores that there are alternate glasses that people are buying because they seem to sync with the product that, like the TV set they're buying, and it may be less expensive. And we don't recommend that. I would say, through my testing, that the critical nature of the TV to glasses interface is too carefully constructed to just put any pair of glasses with any TV.
Mm. Well, I can certainly see that. Do you test aftermarket or third-party glasses at all, or do you just not even get into that?
Well, it's not appropriate for me to say. We are members of 3D at Home and have looked at a lot of different products, you know, with that kind of background.
Okay. Well, let's get back to the process. We kind of got a little sidetracked with 3D, which is fine.
So you were talking about the testing.
Exactly.
So it may take, a couple of days of testing because we may spend a whole day just tuning the picture modes with static images. That would be your grayscale boxes and your different primary colors and secondary colors. And that's not an easy task with these TVs. They're very complicated. And they keep refining them and changing them. The recent power requirements caused a lot of plasma manufacturers to have to redevelop the chemical formulas of their phosphors so that they would light with less power. So as soon as you start changing the chemicals and you've changed the amount of time it takes for the phosphor to light or decay, and then that changes how you can mix the colors and how carefully or critically you can mix the colors. So it can take a whole day or longer. We get multiple software updates. The engineers work really hard. This is some people say iterative, but I think it's more just a practical matter of trying to make the new design work most accurately. So then we move to moving picture viewing. We have some test images that are moving to show us how the TV does with objects that move at a steady rate or that may cause jaggies. That may have poor switching between color and grayscale and interlaced. And we look at contouring, and we play black and white movies and color film and color video. So these different sources all help us detect errors that sometimes software can be adjusted to correct. And it, I guess lastly, that viewing time helps us set the internal adjustments of our mode. You'll see that on some TVs, certain features are grayed out. And that's because we felt that it changed the picture too much. It may have softened the picture, may have cleaned up the film grain, or it may have added harsh edges on something. So we'll look at these different GUI options and choose something that is the, I don't know, the best representation. And then say, okay, let's set it there, and they do a software lock before it goes to manufacture.
Now that does bring up a point that I wanted to ask you about, which is when I'm reviewing TVs, and I've reviewed quite a few THX certified TVs, in some cases, when you select the THX mode, and this is one of the picture modes that you can always select in a THX certified display, you can select dynamic and standard and vivid and cinema and THX. And when you select THX, in some cases, you still have access to the basic picture controls, for example, like contrast, brightness, color, tint, sharpness.
Yeah.
And in some cases, you don't. Those are all grayed out.
Right. And this was a choice that the manufacturer made. We don't require that they lock or leave things unlocked. The only thing I require is that when you press the reset button, it goes back to the factory setting.
That was determined through the certification process.
That's right.
Yeah, okay. Well, certainly, I want to make sure that we understand that the whole point of THX, the raison d'être of THX, is to present content as the content creator intended. And so that's really the basic mission of certification, right? Is to make sure that the display, or in the case of audio, the audio device, reproduces the content as accurately as possible, right?
Right. And so the way we arrived at the specification was looking at the standards bodies and the way that production houses tune their screens. So I've got a post-production background, as did other people who helped develop the spec. And if you look at ITU BTER 709, it lays out what the picture should be as far as the white point and the different colors. And that is the basis of what we want, because that's what they do in Hollywood. When they take a film, nowadays it's presented mostly in digital format, and that's a different color timing than 709. So the colorist has to sit down and work with the people that are doing the Blu-ray transfer and retune those colors so it's narrowed to the triangle that encompasses the 709 set of colors.
And we have a graphic, by the way. Let me interrupt just for a second to say we have a graphic of that triangle within the CIE diagram. Here it is. Right. We're going to come back to this a little later. For now, let's just take a look at the one on the left.
The left is a little bit smaller. It doesn't encompass the whole range of colors that you might be able to see, which is what the CIE chart is about. It's about
What are the colors you can see? And the CIE chart, the curved shape, some people call it a horseshoe. I don't think it quite looks like a horseshoe, but it is kind of a curvy shape. That is the entirety of the colors that the human eye can see, whereas the triangle inside is the range of colors that the display can reproduce. And I will say this, that regardless of the display technology or however you create a display that uses red, green, and blue, which all of them do virtually at this point, you're never going to be able to recreate all of the colors that the human eye can see, because that triangle is always going to be smaller than that curvy shape, right?
Right. And so since that triangle was specified by ITU, That's what the manufacturers have designed their sets to reproduce. And other devices can make colors that are different. We have wide gamut LCD displays, OLED. Some of the DLP projectors have wider color gamuts. That's why the movies can be presented in a theater with a P3 setting instead of Rec. 709. So,
by the way, I'll just make sure that everybody understands that gamut, G-A-M-U-T, is the word used to, is the label put on that triangle. What is the range of colors that a particular display can reproduce? And it is defined by anything inside that triangle it can do. And that triangle is called the color gamut. So, and there are all kinds of different names for them. Rec. 709 is one of the color gamuts, the one used for high-definition television. P3 is the one used for digital cinema, and it's a much larger triangle than Rec. 709.
Right, and likewise, old standard definition was 601, so it was slightly different. It had more, or shall we say, less green and different shades of red. Mm-hmm. So when we're talking about up conversions, we had to start even in 2006 with the electronic devices as does it convert the color gamut correctly? If it's supposed to switch between a standard definition and a high definition, or a high definition Blu-ray disc down to a standard definition presentation for a standard definition TV, does it restrict the color gamut? Does it move those primaries to the right places? And now that we're mostly all HD, this is less and less a problem.
Mm-hmm. Web 1544 in the chat room is asking, does the THX profile or setting, picture mode, mean that users don't have to calibrate the TV? Do you test and program the... Does the set come out if it's THX certified in full calibration?
That's a goal. We have a number of THX certified display calibrators, and particularly if you have a projector, you should get your system calibrated. But a professional calibrator could tune a THX TV even closer than it is out of the box. Our goal was to make the TV as close as possible out of the box, and what we saw was early on, I made trips down to the manufacturing plants, and they would do a specific calibration on the assembly line for the THX cinema mode. And because basically all their normal television presets are offsets from the vivid mode. So they can easily set at one time and mathematically calculate all the other settings. But the THX mode was more precise. So they would do a specific calibration for the THX cinema mode. Now, that's not to say that there aren't production variances. And I think some of your articles show that the TV isn't always as linear as it could be in all the colors.
Exactly. I've noticed that THX mode does get pretty close, generally speaking, but it can always be tweaked a little closer. And one reason, I think, is exactly what you just said, that there are tolerances, manufacturing tolerances, such that, you know, one TV coming off the line might have a green point here, and the next TV off the line might have the green point slightly different. The calibrate, you can always tweak it in a little better. Another consideration, I think, is the environment in which the TV finds itself at the end of its journey from manufacturing to home. You guys test in a very blacked out room, right?
Right. It's just a simulated, they call it simulated black room because scientifically speaking, it's supposed to be a chamber. But our room just has no light leakage. And the spectroradiometer aims at only a 2-degree spot on the TV. So long as it's black and there are no reflections, it can do really, really well. The manufacturing process, they usually have an area that's just draped like a darkened area where, I mean, you know, the thing is moving along on a continuously moving track, and the measuring device will track the TV as it goes through this darkened area and do its electronic calibration.
Right, but that's not going to be the same necessarily as somebody's living room.
That's right. Then, so the calibration person can take that into account. They can look at your room, maybe help you change it, or they can tune the TV so it looks as accurate as possible in that environment. That's why early on we were asked to add bright room mode, because cinema mode was too dark for everyday use. It's great to watch a movie late at night, but gee, we watch, you know, the football game at noon, don't we? So the lighting in the room and the lighting from the TV need to all be taken into account or balanced. So we do what we think will work really well for the TV, and a professional calibrator can do what would work best in your house.
Exactly. Web 1544 follows up. So is it safe to say that the THX profile is way better than normal theater mode or cinema mode?
Way better is a hard hard thing to define.
Somewhat better?
Well, we don't know what the manufacturer does with the TV when he takes it back to his office. We're right. Concentrating on the picture quality of the THX-labeled picture modes. And if the manufacturer wants to take those settings and all that balancing that's done in the firmware and apply it to some other mode, sure, go ahead. And is it way better? Well, no, but it's as accurate as it can be. And certain feature sets are turned off so that you get the grain from the movie. In other words, I guess we call it, you know, do no harm.
Right. SoCal Ray Jr. in the chat room has asked a question that's a little off topic, but I want to get it in here before we get too much farther. Are you involved at all in the THX video calibration program, the educational program that teaches calibrators how to calibrate?
No, I don't. I sat with John Dahl as we discussed how to present these high-definition products. We kind of coordinate whenever there's questions or if a new technology comes out. Like when 3D started, we talked to each other about some of the problems that calibrators were having in homes with 3D and how we test. And then he can describe to the class how THX does things, and maybe they can emulate the testing procedure to get as accurate as a measurement they can.
Mm-hmm. The real question that SoCal Ray Jr. is asking is, what are the plans for the THX video calibration program? He claims that there was not a class at 2012 CEDIA or 2013 CES. I don't remember if that's true. I assume he would know because he keeps track of these sorts of things. I don't know that you might know the answer to that question.
I just don't. Yeah. I think you know John Dahl.
I do.
And, you know, we can pop him a question, or you can write. I have a email address for all kinds of questions that people sometimes write into thxdisplays@thx.com. So if he had a question like that and I could forward it on, I'd be happy to.
Okay. So Cal Ray Jr., thxdisplays@thx.com. Shoot that off to Eric here, and he'll make sure that you get the answer to that question. I don't know whether or not they're going to have THX video certification classes at CEDIA this year. Maybe they aren't scheduled yet, but we're still some months out, although I have just started to make my hotel reservation. let's get back to the process. We're sort of taking a few detours here, but back to the main process. After you've looked at the prototype and you've worked with the engineer and you've set things up, they still have to come back to you with a production unit to check, right?
Well, they don't. They just send it in. There's no need for an engineer to come and be all involved with that.
Sometimes they are, sometimes they're not.
Yeah, usually not. There's been occasions where we have a question, we wonder about a certain software setting, or maybe something doesn't quite measure the way we want. It doesn't take too long to make a couple emails, and they'll either resubmit another sample, or I'll send it down to whoever's close. You know, sometimes Epson and JVC have a local, local meaning like in California, location where they could test something, or they'll test it in Japan and send me their numbers. You know, we have a really good working relationship. But once it's left the picture quality department at the manufacturer, it's kind of like out of their hands unless they want to do a field upgrade. And I don't know how you feel about field upgrades. We try to discourage it. So we work really hard at, you know, getting everything into it before the software's locked.
Right. Well, field upgrades by firmware aren't necessarily a bad thing. It's relatively easy to do as long as the TV has an Ethernet connection, which most of them do. A hardware upgrade, that's another story.
Right. You pretty much can't do a hardware upgrade. I don't appreciate, well, that's not a really fair word. I guess I don't feel that all the TVs will get upgraded if you wait for a field upgrade, because there's plenty of sets that will never, ever be connected to the internet. I think even with the new smart TV features, a lot of people are buying a TV, they set it up, and they watch TV. And it may never, ever be connected to the internet. Mm-hmm. The newest TVs that we just got through testing all have wireless Wi-Fi built in. So even that idea may be starting to change. You know, these TVs kind of phone home right away through the setup procedure. It's are you connected with a wire or wirelessly? And then please enter your login codes. And then it says, so there's an update available. Do you want us to update? And you click it. So if there, but there's a lot of ifs there.
Yeah.
Does the TV have a connection? Is there a connection in the house? Does the person want to let it change the TV? So I don't believe that all TVs will get field upgraded, even if they're capable.
So I will say this. Understood. I will say this. Samsung has announced since last year field upgradable hardware in the form of these little modules. They're called Smart Evolution Kit Module. And this year they announced that of their TVs that have this, which is just a little hardware box that you can, that they'll bring out every year with upgraded features and hardware and stuff, and you can plug them into this TV, they guarantee that they will be upgradable for the next 4 years, which I think is a pretty interesting idea that I don't think I've ever seen any other manufacturer do. Have you?
No, we haven't. Samsung's not one of our licensees, and the other manufacturers haven't shown that sort of hardware change.
Mm-hmm.
I think that these TVs should last 4 years without changing the hardware, actually.
Well, now that's a very good point. You know, it used to be, I remember my parents' day and even my grandparents' day, people would keep TVs for 15, 20, 25 years. That does not seem to be the way it is today.
No, they're more of a commodity, although they're not inexpensive.
No.
We, you know, have several TVs at my house, and they've been running for several years, flat panels, that is. And I don't know why they would fail unless, say, maybe they have a fan that overheats, or maybe I'd replace it because there's a feature it doesn't have, but it isn't because of a hardware deficiency.
Yeah. And it's not going to be because all of a sudden the video standards have changed, although that may be coming in the future, which I want to get to in just a second. If you'll hang on for a moment, I do want to take a moment to thank our sponsor for this episode, which is manpacks.com. Now, most of our viewers and listeners are guys. We know this, 90-some percent, no doubt. And there's always basic stuff, you know, that guys need but always forget to buy until it's too late. You know, finding good products like underwear and socks, facial scrubs, shaving stuff. Not that I have anything to do with that, but most guys do. Many guys do. You need these things every day, but, you know, where are you going to go out shopping? I hate shopping. I don't know about you, but, you know, shopping for that kind of stuff is last on my list. So even surfing the web for socks is no great thrill, that's for sure. So manpacks.com has the solution, which is you don't have to shop only once. You just have to tell manpacks.com which products you like and how often you want to get them. I think they come every 3 months or so. You can update your order anytime you want, and it just automatically shows up on your doorstep. So these basic sorts of things that we all need becomes no longer a chore. And they have a great variety and selection of things, too. They even carry the socks and underwear that I wear. So they sent me a great T-shirt that's really very high quality. They got bunches of T-shirts. Lipstick, chapstick kind of stuff, you know, for sun protection. Not lipstick, of course, but chapstick and face protection, that sort of thing. Certainly something I like to wear because I hate getting sunburned, which I do so easily. Anyway, you can update this anytime you want. You get it shipped to you automatically. It's all very, very easy. Free shipping, free returns, easy account management. And at Manpacks, as they say, the customer is always king. Now, there are two exclusive offers for Twit listeners that I want to make sure that you understand and know about. All you have to do is visit manpacks.com/twit, and you'll get $10 off your first order of $30 or more, or buy a $50 gift card for $40. So go to manpacks.com/twit and get started today. And we thank Manpacks so much for their support of Home Theater Geeks and the entire Twit network. Okay, so I wanted to now get to the future of television. We sort of know that 4K or UHD, Ultra HD, is coming. And I wonder if, I hope that THX is prepared for that and ready to certify these ultra high definition displays.
Right. Well, we have announced a 4K certified product. It's by Sharp, who have been a partner with THX for a long time. I believe they did the first certified display with us. And so they've done the first 4K certified display with us. And unfortunately for, well, us in the United States, it's a Japanese-only product. That's not to say that there aren't 4K products, say, you can get here in the U.S., but we're still kind of in the infancy of getting any 4K content. So one of the things that THX is working on is ways to test the upscaling and upconversion of the HD sources into a 4K panel.
Which is going to be the most important source of content, at least at the beginning.
Did you have an awareness of some 4K content that people can view?
Actually, I do. There is, when you buy the Sony Ultra HD flat panel, they provide along with it for only $25,000 a video server, a computer that's dedicated to serving 4K content, and it comes with it on the hard disk 10 4K native 4K movies, and they'll deliver to you Blu-ray data discs. Very important to make that distinction. They're not video discs. There's no 4K Blu-ray video disc standard. But right, there are Blu-ray data discs, and they will deliver to you new 4K movies, additional 4K movies, that you throw this disc into this server, and it will load onto the hard drive, and then you can watch these 4K movies. This is the only 4K content that I know of that is currently available to people with the Sony 4K display. I don't know whether or not it will feed any other display, even Sony's 4K projector, which came out first. I don't know that. I have to find that out. I have to ask Sony. Of course, people are talking about terrestrial broadcast, about streaming, and downloading. Sony's talking about downloading. But none of that's been settled yet. So for the most part, what we're going to be dealing with is upscaled 1080p.
Right. So what we get into with upscaling 1080p is, well, how do we present the 1080 image on a 4K TV? And because of THX philosophy of not changing the content, we are expecting that the 4K TVs will display it in the 709 gamut. And the reason is that that's the way it was mastered, and those are the colors that you expect to be presented in the home. If you were to move the colors to the 4K spec, which is called Rec 2020, then you have interpolated colors or fake colors that the TV or Blu-ray disc player might be trying to create. So
we can see that on this, that CIE diagram. Here it is again. And we can see on the left, BT or Rec 709, that triangle is the range of colors that a high-definition TV should be able to reproduce. And on the right, we see the BT 2020, which is much, much larger.
Right. So anything that is not within the 709 triangle yet presented on the TV would be colors that aren't in the source. So it would be nearly impossible for anybody to qualify that the interpolated colors are correct. So we're asking the THX modes to do 709 when it's a standard 2K source, and then to do Rec 2020 if you have a 4K source. This is not, my suggestion is not that you run out and buy a 4K up-converting Blu-ray player and then feed the TV a 4K HDMI, because then you're just making the fake colors inside the Blu-ray player.
Right.
So we're waiting and hoping, and Sony showed at CES a business plan to make a 4K disc available, and we saw a demonstration at LG's booth, I think, from one of the streaming services, and Samsung was also showing something.
Actually, Samsung was showing Netflix 4K streaming. LG was showing terrestrial broadcast from the Korean broadcast system, which required two antennas feeding two HDMI inputs on the TV. Then Sony was showing their downloads service, or at least they were talking about it. We didn't really see it. One thing about these two different color gamuts that I wanted to get your hit on was Sony and Panasonic were two companies at CES that touted that their TVs could reproduce a wider color gamut. And several TVs have done this in the past as well. Wider, bigger, the larger triangle than Rec 709. And isn't that great? And my argument has always been, well, no, it's not, because what's on the disc is Rec 709. So if you take that and expand it out, you're not getting what the Blu-ray creator intended. And their response to that at CES was, well, yes, but movies are shot at this wider, they're captured in this wider gamut. And when you then expand out 709, you're just getting back what was originally captured in the digital camera. And my response to that was, well, how do you know you're getting exactly what came out? You're sort of guessing. And they said, well, we're Sony. Oh, we're Panasonic. We know what movie colors were, and so we're making a really good guess. what do you say to all of this?
I say the same thing. What we saw early on, and I think some of the professional calibrators saw, and probably still the case, is that your color management systems in the TVs sometimes do a really great job at locating the tips of that triangle. So you can get the green right, and you can get the blue right, and you can get the red right, even at some expanded color gamut. But when you try to do the tracking of how does that green change as it's getting darker and darker and darker, you start to find errors. So they're not always able to tune these errors out, and they don't belong in anything beyond the 709 triangle. Doesn't belong on your standard HDTV anyway. If you want to plug a computer into it and send out some other color gamut and put it into a different mode, I bet it's really valuable that the TV has those wider controls. But mostly the engineer's busy detuning that extreme to get it to the corners of that triangle. And the nice thing is, if it's wider, the engineers can pull it in. You know, and we had a lot of trouble getting it wide enough for a while. So we're kind of happy with the capability of the TVs in the last couple of years and the way they track in 709.
Yeah, that's actually a very good point. It's much easier to take a wider gamut and bring it in than it is to take a too small gamut and expand it out.
Right. You get all kinds of contouring, and you'll get contouring would be where colors don't really change. They sort of flatten. It's when the color clips. So you could have whites.
Or when you get, it's sometimes called banding. Is that what you're talking about? Where a very gradual gradation of color starts looking like it's got, it's solid color bands as it moves from one gradation to another. Is that what you're talking about?
That's also sometimes the case if you're out at the extremes. Sometimes banding happens because it's doing a poor bit rate down conversion. The panels used to be 8-bit panels, and then they would be getting a 10-bit signal, or now you can get a 12-bit signal out of your Blu-ray player, and it has to concatenate these bits into an 8-bit structure. So some colors or shades of color, it can't reproduce that gradation, and you get the banding.
Right.
That's part of our viewing test, to see what happens with those kind of gradations.
Right. Nerve in the chat room is saying, it's like those super megapixel cameras. It allows for cropping, having a wider color gamut. And that's a very good analogy. Another one is taking digital audio samples at a higher rate than you're going to end up with. For example, doing 2496 digital audio recording and then squeezing that down to CD quality, 16441 kilohertz. You get better quality than you do if you simply record at the final stage. Another example is mastering Blu-rays at 4K or even 8K now, and then bringing them down to 1080p gives you a better result than mastering the original film, if it was shot on film, at 1080p to begin with.
Well, they have really sophisticated software and hardware to recalculate where the colors and luminances are supposed to land. It's not as simple as just lopping off the top 10% or something.
Right.
That's part of our challenge with the up conversion to 4K is, are the diagonals and curves really being reconstructed into a 4K space, or are we going back to having steps in our curves like SD to HD does? And it's a complicated thing to position pixels in a place where there didn't used to be any. So, it's a sophisticated and a high computer power process.
Now, that reminds me of another question about LCDs. Does THX certification look at all at frame interpolation in LCD TVs, 120 hertz, 240 hertz TVs with this thing called frame interpolation that creates new frames in between the existing incoming frames to sharpen motion blur? And it also, of course, we know it creates the soap opera effect, which makes movies look like they were shot on video, and people hate that more than they hate motion blur. Is that something THX looks at?
Yes, we look at that. Mostly we turn it off.
As do I.
But there are some benefits. I mean, some LCD panels have had lag. And so depending on what they're doing with the motion interpolation. Sometimes they can do black frame insertion, which doesn't really change the frame rate. It only flashes the backlight to give your image a more, or shall we say, a less smeared effect on moving objects.
Right.
The frame interpolation that is in maybe the next higher selection in the menu would probably, instead of doing simple black frame insertion, may put a fake frame in between. And I'm sure there's programs that would really benefit from that. But THX thinks that, if the movie judders because the cameraman moved his camera very quickly, well, that's what you should see. And that's what you're going to get, unless you choose to turn it on yourself. We don't tell them to gray it out. We want it to be available to the user.
Mm-hmm. Agent X in the chat room is asking, why don't we look at getting home theater into the professional cinema color space? And really, it's the color gamut that he's talking about there. Is there a move, once 4K becomes standard, will we see that expanded color gamut in home theater?
I don't really know what the overlay is on the gamuts between 2020 and P3. I think it encompasses most of what P3 is. The question is accurate from the viewer's perspective is that if we can get a 4K signal, if the people will transfer it in a wider gamut, then we may have as close to a theater experience as possible. It's only recently that TVs can really get that wide. Projectors have been able to have wider color gamuts for a while.
Right. Nerve in the chat room asks a related question. With large gamut TVs, I would imagine that the home theater could potentially deliver viewers movies that are not stuck in Rec 709. Would you agree?
I guess that's accurate. I don't, I watch a lot of video. And I also see movies at home that I've seen at the theater. And I'm really hard-pressed to tell the difference most of the time. I mean, like 90% of the time, I can't tell you the difference. If you listen to a live concert and then go home and play it on your stereo, that's entirely different. But if you go and watch a movie, it actually is a video projection or presentation, and yet you're coming home to watch another video presentation of it. And your mind doesn't remember what color green you saw. And
right.
That's one of the things that's really great about TV is that, at anybody's house, you can still tell that the Coca-Cola logo is the Coca-Cola logo, but they're never the same color.
They're never quite the same color red. And TVs today cannot reproduce the exact color of red that Coca-Cola uses in its logo and so on. I've always found that interesting.
Oh, yeah. We had a lot of challenges with them as a client in duplication and distribution.
Coca-Cola was a client of yours?
Well, not personally, but where I worked, Coca-Cola was, we worked at a facility that distributed commercials to TV stations. And so the clients are the agencies. And so if Leo Burnett brings in a commercial by a client, they want that color to be the right color. And boy, we had a lot of challenges with calibrating monitors and equipment to make sure that those colors, the tans and the reds and the blues and the cyans, were in the right place. Because, they want the person to remember the logo as they expect to see it in print and on their sign.
Right, exactly. But that's very hard to do with at least current and past video technology.
It's totally faked in video. It's just the way it is. I mean, that color triangle you can see, it's much smaller than the colors the human eye can see.
Right, exactly.
And it's smaller than what people can print. So you have quite a lot of experts working between the print and the film and the video groups to make the images as close to each other as they can, going back to the caller who said, will it look like at the theater? And I'm saying your mind will have a really hard time recollecting what you saw at the theater if your TV is doing a good job.
Right, right. Were you involved at all in the THX tune-up app?
We did a lot of testing on the tune-up app. We, for the people that didn't haven't got it, the it offers some tests that are similar to what Optimizer used to do. So you can set up your brightness and your black levels, shall we say, contrast brightness, color and tint, and then we look at some photos to see if they seem normal to the person who, you know, is looking at the TV. So we
Sorry, go ahead.
Well, we were just involved from the beginning as to how could we transform what we had success with in Optimizer into an application that a person could download on his mobile device, and how would he be able to adjust a TV using it. So we couldn't supply, you know, you want to sit around and wait for a pair of blue glasses to come in the mail. So we had to come up with a new way of doing some filtering to help the user balance the color and the tint.
And I must admit, it's a very cool app, actually. I have it on my iPhone, and you can get it in the App Store or on Android. Is it only iPhone, or is it now Android as well? I've forgotten.
It's not on Android yet.
Not yet. Okay. But you can get it in the App Store for, I think, $1.99, something like that. iPhone Kiki in the chat room is asking, why doesn't the THX tune-up app have sharpness test pattern?
We experimented with sharpness a little bit. And I felt that the sharpness pattern would only start to make enough problem to the user if he moved his control quite a long distance one way or the other from the center. We've tested a lot of TVs, and the sharpness is really not accentuated because you already have a lot of detail from HD sources.
On the other hand, the part of the problem with the sharpness control is if it's set too high, and in my experience, it's often set too high by default, you get edge enhancement, you get ringing, you get some distortion around sharp edges. And my advice generally is to turn the sharpness down as low as you can or almost as low as you can. Sometimes it tends to soften things if you click it down to zero, but generally you need to turn it down. So I would have thought that that would have been a useful thing to have in there.
Well, we'll take it under advisement from you and the viewer. We really need to come up with a pattern, not just a simple line, to look at sharpness, because it can be subtle. It can sometimes show up as ringing, which would be repetitive shapes following the original source shape. Sometimes it's white, sometimes it's black. Sometimes it's not even seen on a static object now, but is seen more often on a moving object. So we were concerned that it was pretty complicated for a version one kind of installation. And I think, well, you know, we've had a number of people ask for it, and we'll try to devise something.
Okay, great. One last thing. We have two other graphics that I really wanted to show. And this has to do with uniformity. And this is a big problem, particularly with LCD TVs, I think. Would you agree that uniformity is a big problem with especially edge-lit LCD TVs?
Yeah, edge-lit TVs, by nature, have a hard time getting the light to the middle of the TV. The picture that you can show that shows the poorly done says without THX certification. That's
uniformity one. There it is. Uh-huh.
Yeah. It is actually shot by an imaging photometer. And it presents this histogram where the orange is the lightest and the blue is the darkest. So what we see is a lot of light coming from the one side of the TV. And in this case, it really wasn't. Some TVs have lights on more than one edge, which improves this a lot. There are other TVs that have light pipes that they can do a quasi-local dimming by sending light down the light pipes to different regions of the TV. But what we really like is a TV that has a full backlight array. Because you don't want these splotches of lightness. And what you see in an LCD when it's not even, it is mostly in the dark. You don't see it so much in the light. Because
but dark scenes like outer space or at night, that kind of thing.
Right, and certain spots will seem brighter, like these orangey areas will seem brighter than the rest of the TV in the darker grays, even though it's the same phenomenon if it's white or black. Right. The other picture shows the passing TV, and that's a full array backlight TV, and we measure the color and the luminance in those 9 locations because we want it to be as pure as possible. You know, on the edges, the same as in the center.
Mm-hmm. Well, this certainly gives us a great sense of why full array backlighting is better than edge lighting. But very few TVs actually implement it because it's more expensive, for one thing. And you can't make the TV quite as thin. And that seems to be one of the things that everybody really wants is super thin TVs.
Yeah, the thinness has become an engineering challenge for everybody. SID has a number of seminars talking about light diffusion, and some people are starting to put LEDs in the back of the TV and use a prism so that the light shines up into the prism and then out the front of the TV through a diffusion screen. And, you know, it suffers from hot spotting or light and dark areas just the same. You have to have a lot of LEDs to really cover the back light evenly. And you have to have a lot of control because you can have different LEDs of different brightnesses, even though you might just measure the current. So the certified TVs that we did had regionally controlled backlights so that they could balance that light evenly, you know, over many, many, they're squares, really, regions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, great. Thank you so much. We've come to the end of a fascinating hour, and I want to thank you very much for being here and explaining the ins and outs of THX video certification. I certainly do recommend looking for THX certification in your TV and other devices when you can, because it does assure a certain level of performance. So,
Scott, tell him one more time, if you want to ask a question you think of later, THX displays at THX.com is the email address for, you know, question answers.
Excellent. We'll
try to get you an answer if we can.
THX displays at THX.com. And of course the website THX.com has a bunch of great information there too. Thank you so much, Eric Gemmer.
Thank you.
All right. So again, THX.com and THXdisplays.com, THXdisplays at THX.com for your questions. You can find me at avsforum.com, also at hometheaterhifi.com. You can follow me on Twitter at you can email me at scott@twit.tv. You can follow me on Twitter at htgeekscott. And you can find previous episodes of Home Theater Geeks at twit.tv/htg or on its new YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/twit/hometheatergeeks. Next week, my guest geek is scheduled to be Tyle Hertzens, the editor of innerfidelity.com, to talk all about the world of headphones. I'm going to ask him about wireless headphones in particular because I've got a lot of comments and questions about wireless headphones and where that's going. So should be a lively discussion. He's always a great guest. He's been on several times. So I do hope you will join me then. Until then, geek out.